The next item that I want to talk about in this hour of Kwonmunism is this thing that a lot of the left-wing or leftist-leaning media is labeling as Million Moron March, which is a pretty funny pun. But I don't necessarily totally agree with that, but that's what's just saying that kind of gives you a good idea of what I'm going to be talking about, which is this call to arms by, you know, people who own guns, people who strongly believe in the Second Amendment, to gather together and march to Washington, D.C. with their guns locked and loaded. March to Washington, D.C. in the spirit and in the manner in which Martin Luther King Jr. conducted the Million Man March during the Civil Rights Movement in the 1960s, early 1960s. So that's a topic I want to talk about. It's an interesting call to arms, really. It's, in a way, you know, the people who are for doing this is saying this is an act of civil disobedience, which technically it is. It's because in Washington, D.C., it's not legal to, if I'm correct, I think the law is that you can't carry, you know, a loaded rifle openly in that city. It's one of the cities with very strict gun control laws, comparing it to many other cities in the United States. Most American cities have very loose gun control laws, but really populated cities like Los Angeles, Chicago, Detroit, for example, and New York, and especially Washington, D.C., have really, really strict gun laws. I live in New York City, and New York City has ridiculously strict gun laws, some of which I'm a centrist in this issue, leaning more towards gun ownership rights. But I am a centrist in the sense that I'm not against all forms of gun control. Some forms of gun control I do kind of support. But just that's my background here. Really, you know, it is that in that sense they are breaking the law in order to kind of show to the federal government that this law is something they don't consider as just or right. So Martin Luther King said about civil disobedience that we have a moral obligation to follow and uphold laws that we consider just, and we have a moral obligation to disobey laws that we consider unjust and immoral. In Martin Luther King Jr.'s time, what he was talking about in that context was a law about segregation, the Jim Crow laws, racist laws, consider laws based on skin color and skin complexion and race. That was what he was fighting for, and he took million people. That was the name, but he didn't take million people. But he took, you know, he encouraged a lot of people to march up to Washington, D.C. in opposition to Jim Crow laws. And now that's been a historic thing, and many movements have kind of tried to mimic this. And that movement in American history, of course, Martin Luther King Jr. kind of modeled that off of Gandhi's march in India. So it's really amazing, it's interesting to see how other kind of issues and organizations use this method. But the problem, I think, the biggest problem with this this particular march about gun ownership rights is that it has a potential to be extremely violent. That's, you know, I'm not saying it shouldn't be done. You know, if gun people are really that strongly believing in gun ownership rights, go for it, I guess. If you think it's really that important of an issue, go for it. I don't own guns, so I'm not going to join you, and I don't want to make a trek to Washington, D.C. from here. It's a 6-hour drive from here, but go for it, I guess. But the problem is, it can end up pretty badly, because you have this large group of people who have their guns locked and loaded. Yeah, I do agree that many gun control laws in Washington, D.C. are pretty ridiculous, some of them. Some of the ones I looked at is like, you have to keep your guns, ammo and gun separate in a different cabinet. You can't have it locked and loaded. So it doesn't allow you to use your gun in a situation where you need to use your gun. a lot of laws in Washington, D.C. are problematic, and so they're kind of protesting against the unjust nature of these laws by marching, which is great. That concept is great. But the potential for danger here is just crazy, because these are armed. Usually marches like these are nonviolent marches. So if the government agents respond to this march negatively, it makes the government agents look bad, because they're hurting people who are not armed, who are trying to be nonviolent and just taking beatings. It's what made the nonviolent movement in India's liberation from Britain so effective. It's what made the civil rights movement led by Martin Luther King Jr. So effective, and it's almost why we kind of, as a general consensus, kind of vilified Malcolm X's movement, which I personally consider as just as impactful and just as important. But we do have this reverence for Martin Luther King Jr. because the manner he conducted the march was, or the movement for racial equality was nonviolent and peaceful. This march, you know, going in with guns locked and loaded, it may share the same kind of method, but it doesn't share the same spirit. Because what happens when government agents crack down on this protest, as government agents are prone to do? It happens a lot. It doesn't matter what issue it is, it's prone to happen. Whether it's Tea Party or Occupy Wall Street movement or whatever, government agents do tend to not like, you know, the government doesn't tend to like massive protests. So there's always this tension between people protesting and the establishment. What happens when the establishment cracks down on these people who are marching with guns locked and loaded? That's the question. This has a potential for really a good amount of violence. If somebody... The thing about people, a large group of people armed, the one thing that always has a potential of happening is one person or very few people fire. And that fire causes a chain reaction in which one side fights, the other side fights back, and it becomes this bloody battle. That's, you know, if you look at the history books, that is in essence how the Revolutionary War in America started. With the gunshot that rang around the world, that's the phrase. You know, there were two sides in Bunker Hill. They were you know, staring at each other with guns facing each other. And this story, the myth goes, maybe it's not a myth, maybe it's an actual accurate account. But the story goes that the commander of one side said, "Don't shoot," or "Don't fire." One person or many people didn't hear the "don't" part. It just kind of, that went through one ear and went out the other, and fire, and heard the word fire or shoot, and shot. And that gunshot, of course, elicited a response from the other side, and they just started battling each other. I mean, the Revolutionary War was a build-up. You know, even without that battle, it would have happened because of the nature of the British rule and of the American colonies. But that's one scenario, and it's possible in this scenario as well. People in large groups with their guns loaded, government agent kind of tries to crack down, and the response happens. It has a potential for being really ugly and really bloody. If that happens, the potential for that, is it going to be a good thing for people who are, you know, proposing for, you know, more strict following of the Second Amendment? It could be a backlash to them. It could be backlash to, they're hoping it'd be a backlash to the establishment, to the government, who have strict gun control laws. But it can turn out to be a really opposite, in the opposite direction, if this ends up being really violent and bloody and such. So I'm not totally opposed to the idea of having a protest and marching for Second Amendment. But this concept of marching with guns locked and loaded as a huge group can be extremely potentially dangerous. And, you know, that potential is there. But I do agree that, you know, I'm a centrist in an issue leaning towards Second Amendment, because I do believe the government should fear the people. And the best way the government is able to, you know, is kept in check and kept in fear of the populace that it governs is if the populace is armed with guns. So I definitely think that's really important. Second Amendment to me is really important amendment, just like with many other Bill of Rights in the Constitution. I don't think, you know, the priority, you know, when you were comparing the priority of Second Amendment compared to First Amendment or to the Fourth Amendment or to the Ninth Amendment or whatever, it's not a, you know, I can't really rank above or one or the other, but I think all these amendments are really important in order to have an American society as good as it can be, good as it can be. Sorry, that's one of the instances where my Asian accent kind of just comes out like that for some weird reason. But yeah, that's my thoughts on the issue. Overall, it's pretty much me just saying that, look, guys want to do it, but just understand that doing this has a huge potential for really bloodiness and danger. And I hope nothing bad happens if they go through with this. Hope nothing bad happens. But you know, you never know with this thing.